Now some young pop champagne, they know the face and they know the name.
Jason Parker, we're in downtown Washington, D.C., where I'm sitting here with MMG and Bad Boy recording artist Frank Montana.
Work, what you twerk with? Going, show me what you twerk with.
What's going on, man?
What up, my brother?
Thanks for being here today, man.
No problem, thank you, man. You know,
one of the questions that I always ask is, what does real hip hop mean to Frank Montana?
Real hip hop to me is basically living your music and music making you feel some kind of way.
Money don't mean nothing. Niggas don't feel you when they see it. My whole hood love me, but now a nigga wanna touch me. I ain't worried about nothing.
Wait. You know, to some people it's lyrics, to some people, but to me I feel like just being able to go through emotions through your music and really, you know, loving it.
You ended up with MMG and Bad Boy. Tell me how that came about and why you thought that that was the move for you with all the other things that you had going on.
I mean, when I created my buzz off everything that I've been doing, as far as the mixtape, DVDs, radio, it wasn't one label that didn't have a contract at my lawyer's office. Mm-hmm. And I mean, me and Ross, I knew Ross since I first started, so he always helped me.
Right.
You know, then. Now, I know Kanye, Shawn Reed, Jay-Z, everybody, so.
Right.
Then I sat down with Puff, he's from New York. You know, and I don't look at Puff as an artist. I look at him as, you know, as an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
So I felt like that I had to keep Rick Ross involved in my deal. And plus.
Out of loyalty. Okay.
And plus with Puff, I felt like he could take me somewhere where a regular rapper can't take me. I felt like he'd give me different ventures, you know?
Definitely. Well, with the first week sales of 56, I think you're up to 87,000 sales now. Where do you see your career right now, and where do you see yourself in 5 years? How do you stay relevant, and how do you stay with your longevity?
I've been doing it 10 years before I was known, so. I feel like I'm only getting bigger and bigger every year.
Right.
I just know to hustle, you know? I know how to hustle and I make great music.
No doubt.
And I did it without no labels, without no nothing. So now the help is just helping me.
What's the influence behind the reggae infused beat and the new single with Nicki Minaj?
She pull a boys when a freaker. Brag on her boys, they be doing the most. If I look at his friend, he be gripping the toe. So I took him to the crib to kill him with it. Put my legs behind my head, I hit the ceiling with it.
I just felt like it's been a lack in Jamaican music. As far as reggae music, I felt like you probably didn't hear no reggae music since that the original record came out.
Right.
You know, so.
Freaks was big when it came out before, man.
I was a big fan of that song.
Yeah.
And Rico Love made it over. And it was just a great song. I played it for Nicki Minaj. She loved it. She did a verse. I was like, let's go with it. Something different.
No doubt. What was, how does your Sunni Muslim background and Moroccan culture affect your craft?
I feel like my Moroccan background and, you know, being from North Africa and coming from a third world country, it just helped me with the hustle. You know, over there, we really had no hope. You know, we still don't got no hope. I mean, you don't hear about no superstars coming from them.
Right. When did you come out to America?
When I was 13.
When you were 13. So you really had some time out there,
yeah,
man.
Definitely.
And so you heard about the Biggies and the Tupacs,
yeah,
all the way across the world, man.
Yeah.
Who inspired you to do what you do? Who's your biggest inspiration?
Probably said Tupac. I used to love his music. He was the first person I really, like, I really love his music.
Right. Mm-hmm. Let me ask you a question. Do you think that artists have to conform to stereotypes or industry stereotypes to stay relevant, or do you think they have the freedom to just be themselves, and you in particular?
Yeah, I feel like it's growth when you are yourself.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like when you follow a facade or a trend or whatever it is, I feel like you're only gonna be as hot as whatever you're following.
Right.
I feel like if you yourself, you grow. People love you for you. I feel like, you know, music now is more about buying into the person. You know, and I really feel like, you know, the only way to become a superstar is to be yourself.
We're at a Sweet 16 birthday party. You're about to go on stage. You're a father. How has fatherhood changed you as a person and as an artist?
It changed me just, you know, look at life, you know, have something to live for. You know, and definitely leaving something for your kids. You know, that's why we work so hard, yeah.
No doubt. Last question. What is the message that you're sending to your audience with your new album out, and who is French Montana?
The message I'm sending out to my audience, my fans, is good music. That's how I was feeling at the time, and that's how I came across. French Montana is definitely somebody that came from the bottom, you know what I'm saying?
And now we're here.
We're showing progress, you know what I'm saying? The face of the struggle, you know what I'm saying? You can make it.
Right.
You can come from another country and make it. You come from the gutter and make it. You know, everybody got a lane, a path, and I feel like, you know, you can do whatever. None is impossible.
That's what's up, man. Thanks for talking to me. I really appreciate your time. You're live with Jason Parker. It's French Montana in the building. Appreciate you watching.
Yo, what up, man? It's your homie Ace Hood, and you're live with your man Jason Parker. You understand me?
Yeah. What's up, y'all? You know what it is, your boy Jay kissing right now. You're live with my man Jason Parker.
What's up? It's your boy French Montana, right here chilling with my dog Jason Parker. Holla at your boy, huh?